And there's always some discrepancies, but you're never quite sure. But it's great to be here, and it's great to talk about Tucker and history. This is pretty cool, because you can see the same picture from where we're standing, probably back in the 1800s, maybe the 1890s. And this is from one of the old postcards. A lot of the background images I have today are from my wife's Aunt Red, which is our next door neighbor, Elsie Driscoll, who lives next to us. She's got a great collection of old Tuckerton postcards, and I was able to take pictures of her old postcards for a lot of these background images to give a flavor of what town was like at different times. Today, I work for the New Jersey Pine Lands Commission. I basically educate people about the Pine Lands and the Pine Barrens, and I do a lot of programs with school children and college kids and adults just explaining what the Pine Barrens are and why we protect the area. And it all runs in because, we're right here on the edge of the Pine Barrens here in Tuckerton. My topic today is pretty much a local history of Tuckerton. And this is a mix of things I've learned, I've researched, but it's also just a lot of stories that have been passed down over the generations. I can't say this is going to be a complete objective program, because whenever you talk about your own history, I'm sure you're going to do some self-editing along the way somewhere. And I may remember things different than other people. People may remember the story different. And as we're going along, I look at this as a conversation. So feel free to ask me questions or raise your hand, let me know, and we can all have a talk about Tuckerton history as opposed to me just rattling off a bunch of facts that I may have right or may have wrong, or who knows.
Do you still live in Tuckerton?
I still do, yeah. I live on Wood Street, and my wife Jill's right here, and we live in her grandma's old house, which was a dairy, over right on Wood Street in Tuckerton. She ran the Dawn Dairy for many years, and we've got a bunch of chickens, so we still kind of have it as a farm, but we don't have any cows or horses or donkeys at this point in time.
Is your wife related to Connie Olson? She's a Wood.
My wife is related to the Heinrichs and the Richmonds.
Yeah. You're on Wood Street.
Warren Wood Street.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yep.
It's okay.
Yep. And with that, I'll start the program, and we'll take a step back in time, and talk about how we got kind of where we are today. And I like this map, because this is a Dutch map, but what it really shows is all of the different Native American peoples all over, a good portion of the East Coast. You can see there's a whole bunch of different tribes, different Native people. We know specifically in this area down here in South Jersey, at the time, say, of European settlement, members of the Anakwan or the Lenape people were for the most part living in this area. But from our archaeological records, we can go back 10, maybe 12,000 years, and there's very, very early Native Americans who were living here in the area. We don't have a lot of history or knowledge who those people were, but we found their tools, we found their remnants. There's their shell piles here. We know that there was a significant presence of people, even say 12,000 years ago here in South Jersey. So that's really where the story would talk. If you're gonna talk about Tuckerton, you wanna talk about everybody who's ever lived here, and you really wanna go back that far based on what we know from the archaeological records. This is kind of where the area I like to start, because this is the inlet, today known as Little Egg Inlet. It's been known as different inlets at different times. The sands have shifted, the inlets shifted. It's not always been the same spot, but whenever people first came to the area, they came through the inlet originally, and that's where the area gets its name. We reference Little Egg Harbor a lot. If we go back, there's a good portion of time where the area was referenced as Egg Harbor. And that really makes things confusing, because today there's an Egg Harbor Township, there's an Egg Harbor City, there's a Little Egg Harbor Township, so it really gets confusing, particularly if you're reading an older book, or an older primary source, because that's going to be in the terms of the times, not how we know it today. So where does that come from? This is just the end. So that was the end of Holgate, where Tucker's Island was. We'll talk about that later. And this is over here on the other side, where Little Beach is. I had mentioned in passing that my grandfather was born out there on Little Beach. And so it really goes back to about 1614, and Captain Cornelius Jacobson was part of Henry Hudson's expedition, and it was his job to come down to this area and he gets the credit for quoting in the inlets and bays, the mouths of two rivers refers to the Little Lake Harbor and the Great Egg Harbor. And they're known in the countryside as Eyre Haven. And that's where that Egg Harbor comes from, Eyre Haven. And later it was known as Egg Harbor. So basically, if you talk about Egg Harbor, it's a pretty large area. You could go from St. Barnegat Inlet all the way down to Great Egg, which is down by Summers Point. Yeah. So it's really a large area. The idea of smaller towns and communities at that time wasn't so much, you know, identified. By the 1630s, the 1650s, that's when the Europeans are first going to start to kind of come into southern New Jersey. Over in Salem County, Greenwich area, along that area, we're going to have Swedes and Finns. The Dutch are going to be more in northern New Jersey, but they're going to kind of trickulate down. From what I've read over the years, the Swedes and the Finns had a much more cordial relationship with the native Lenape that were here at the time, whereas the Dutch weren't as friendly. There was more conflicts. There was a couple skirmishes in like central Jersey, northern Jersey, and eventually by the 1650s or so, the Dutch end up kind of in control of all of New Jersey or New Amsterdam at the time. And so that kind of was a souring for the relationship with some of the native people, the native Lenape that were in the area. But that connection to the Swedes was pretty important, because later on, after 1664, after a long war, England's going to take over New Netherlands, and it's then going to come New Jersey. And then with the Treaty of 1672, that's when you get that idea of West Jersey and East Jersey. The line kind of coming from High Point all the way down through New Jersey, slices in half, and ends up out, say, in Little Egg Harbor Bay. So depending on where we're standing in town, you could be in either East Jersey or you could be in West Jersey, but the line kind of split. Most of this area is generally referred to as West Jersey, and for the most part, a lot of West Jersey ended up going to, say, William Penn and some of his partners, and then placements in East Jersey also were sold to some of the other Quaker interests. So ultimately what's going to happen is a lot of the Quaker folks from New England are going to slowly kind of migrate down the coast. Why would they be migrating down the coast? What were they following?
The whales.
Exactly, the whaling industry. So some of the early people that are going to come to this area are going to be connected to whaling or shipbuilding, and they're going to be from Massachusetts, down through Rhode Island, down to Long Island. My family in particular is going to come in about 1635 into Massachusetts. They're going to make their way down into Rhode Island and Long Island, eventually into like places like Queens, and eventually they're going to make it down to the Jersey Shore following the whales. The idea of whaling wasn't so much with a big ship like in Moby Dick, but you could launch a ship off the beach, go out into the surf, and early on, that's where you were able to catch some of the whales. Over time, they either wiped out all those whales, or the whales learned to go further away from shore, so whaling off the beach is no longer going to be an option. But the people had already migrated down south. Places like Monmouth County, like Shrewsbury, over across to, say, Burlington County, and then down into Cape May, all based on that early shipping and whaling industry. We talked a little bit about 1673, where West Jersey was primarily sold to primarily William Penn and some of his partners. And Monmouth, Cape May, and there are going to be a pretty important connection. And if you look at the early maps, you're going to see roads from Monmouth County to Burlington County. Today, Route 537 goes from Mount Holly to Freehold, and that still is the same road. That was that very original way they would go across the state from Monmouth over to Burlington. This is a pretty cool map. This is a mail route. I think this is from 1729. So this is as things are starting to establish. What you really see are all the inlets. So here's Barnegat Bay. You have, this is interesting, Sandy Island. I guess that's an early term for Long Beach Island, which is going to be Long. And then Short, ultimately it's going to be called Tucker's Island. And then Little is the next island over. That's going to be Little Beach. So if you think about it in today's terms, you have Long Beach Island, which ends in Holgate, which is no longer there. You had Tucker's Island,
which at the time was known as Short Beach, and then across the inlet is that's going to be where Little Beach is. But that inlet's changed over the years. Every once in a while you hear the term Beach Haven Inlet. So at one point in time, in part of Holgate, an inlet opened up and really separated the end of Holgate from the rest of Long Beach Island. And that's where Beach Haven Inlet used to go through. But those sands shift, and still to this day, you could be out in the bay and you could run where you ran last year and you could run aground because the sifting sands are always going out there. But this is pretty cool. And this mail route starts, if you read all this, there's three main mail offices: Philadelphia, New York, and Boston. And the mail started in Philadelphia, it would go to Burlington, and then it would come over to Shrewsbury, and then it would head up the coast. And that's interesting. They were that organized in 1729 to have that mail route, which connected almost this whole portion of the eastern seaboard. And then this is my reference to the Pine Barrens. Right here, it references his woodlands. So even back there, the Pine Barrens still really is just an area as woodlands. Even the Native Americans, from what we know, they had more long-term places they lived on the coast, on the Delaware and on the Atlantic. And in the Pine Barrens area, they traveled through and they had routes through, but they didn't really permanently live there. They just kind of went back and forth from side to side. So the more permanent habitation was really along the coast, and that makes sense with all the local resources as far as fish and clams and quahogs. That's really where a bulk of this assistance came from.
This is just a little bit close up. And then you got Little Lake Harbor and Great Lake Harbor. And then here's that line, West Jersey, East Jersey. And a lot of times you see the term for the Lenape referred to as the Delaware, and that's where it comes from. There was an English fellow, and his name was Lord Delaware. And so because the Lenape were living in the area that was at one point in time under his reign, they were the Delaware Indians, although that wasn't what they called themselves. They really called themselves, and the other tribes referred to them as the original people. And so, like when I was a kid, the term I used in school, we were learning about the Lenni Lenape. And now that we understand the Lenape language a little better, what that was saying was the original people. So they referred to themselves as the original people, and a lot of the other tribes also referred to them as the original people. So we know that they were around for a very long time. Now, were they the same people that were here 12,000 years ago? We're not 100% sure, but they may have been connected in some way. So this is a cool picture. I like this picture because this is over by Willow Landing, and this is what it could have been like maybe living here in the 1700s. And in some ways, you can kind of see what it would be like. We've got some traditional boats, but here they're rigged for sail, not with motor. So this photograph probably predates outboard motors, right around when they first started taking photographs. So here we go. Now we'll really get into real specific local history. The 1680s is when we're really going to first see shipbuilding operations along the Jersey Shore. Why? It's for the materials. It's for things like cedar, oak, pitch and tar. Where do you get pitch and tar from?
Pine.
From the pine trees.
Yeah.
New England was famous for the white pines. And the white pines were used for ships' masts. So England, because they were able to control a lot of New England, had a lot of those white pines to build a lot of masts for a lot of their ships, really increased the size of their navy. But the other important components, we don't have the white pine native, but we had the pitch pine, and that's where they could get tar and turpentine and things like that. So it was pretty important as well. Still to this day, there are shipbuilding operations that flourish in the area. So it's part of the local history that's continued many, many years.
In about 1698, there's a fellow named Henry Jacob Falkenberg. He could have been of Swedish descent. He might have been of German descent. We're not really 100% sure. But he had a pretty good relationship with the Lenapes. And he's basically given credit for surveying the area and kind of being the liaison between, say, Thomas Osborne and some of the other people who are going to eventually start to purchase land. Now, we had a great conversation, me and the fellow over here earlier,
the Native Americans didn't really understand the idea of purchasing land. They were part of the land. So how could you own something you're part of? So, you know, were they given money? Were they given a gift? We're not really sure. There was probably some friendly things like beads or clamshells or something given as a present to the Lenape, but they probably didn't understand the concept of them selling the land to somebody else. They may have looked at it, like we said, as a lease. I mean, sure, you could use the land just like I use the land. But the idea of giving their land up was certainly something they probably didn't understand. So a lot of people who have relatives in Tuckman are definitely related to the Falkenberg family. Henry Jacobs is kind of interesting because names were a little bit different back then. So there's a couple different ways to look at it. He could have been Henry, son of Jacob, and then the family name might have been Falkenberg. But we're not really 100% sure. But that's how it is. Not too long after that, right here in Tuckerton proper, Edward and Mordecai Andrews are going to basically set up shop. The old story goes that Edward was on the east side of the dam and Mordecai was on the west side of the dam. They get the first name of the area. I say Middle of the Shore because you see reference to Tuckerton as Middle of the Shore. And it makes sense because you have Cape May, you have Sandy Hook. What's pretty much right in the middle? This area, you know, Egg Harbor, Little Egg Harbor, or what ultimately becomes Tuckerton. So that's where the term Middle of the Shore comes through. Still to this day, there's a road that comes from Mount Holly, goes down through the bottom range out by 539, and comes to Tuckerton, and it's referred to as Andrews Road. And the reason for that is, when they first started to live in the area, they eventually started to grow grain. The only place they could get their grain milled was in Mount Holly. So eventually, Edward Andrews is going to build a grain mill here in Tuckerton, and then that road where they would travel from Tuckerton to Mount Holly is going to get the name of Andrews Road. So the name, first name for Tuckerton, really in a lot of ways, is going to be Andrews Mill. And that's how the area is going to be known once that mill gets up and running. Later on, I think the Shores family owns the mill, and then the area might be referred to as Shores Mill. So that's how things kind of change over time. Now, Edward is pretty interesting. When he first gets down here, now, this is just hearsay or the old story, but from what I read, when Edward first got to the area and other people first started to come on Sundays, he had more of a musical kind of fun gathering. And over time, he kind of got more serious, and then there was also more probably influences from other Quakers in the area. And that's when, instead of just having a fun, entertaining Sunday gathering, they ended up with more of a true traditional kind of Quaker meeting. And somewhere around 1702 to 1704 is when they start to have a permanent Sunday meeting. And then by 1709, not this building, but the building that was here before was constructed. And therefore, you had the Little Egg Harbor Meeting House, or the Egg Harbor Meeting House, back in 1709. That was taken down in about 1863, and that's when this building was replaced. And we'll talk about that as we get down the road a little bit. If you look back, most people in that or in the area today that have relatives that go back that far can probably trace some of their relatives to Edward or Mordecai, or definitely the Falkenbergs, because for sure there were some of the early, you know, families right here in the area. Development of the community. Now, this is a modern picture. This is over at 4th Avenue, looking at what goes into Tuckerton Lake, or what we would call it's Mill Creek. The Mill Creek drainage, as it comes down from Bass River, crosses Poor Man's Parkway. Well, first it crosses the Parkway, then Poor Man's Parkway, comes down through behind Freedom Fields, and eventually comes out into Tuckerton, and this is where it crosses 4th Avenue. Looking towards Tuckerton Lake. So this is looking right at towards, when I was a kid, you'd get in a canoe and it would take about 2 hours and you could canoe from 4th Avenue right down to the lake. I haven't done it in a long time. Now I've upgraded to kayaks. So one of these days I'm gonna put my kayak in and see if we can still make it all the way down to the lake. One of the important things about this area was the natural resources. It was recognized as an unlimited wilderness, unlimited timber, wildfowl, ducks, geese, brant, deer, fish, oysters, all kinds of wild animals. And for years, and still to this day, the area is known as kind of a sportsman's paradise. When I look back to even the pictures from the 20s and the 30s, I see the amount of ducks and fish. It's amazing what they were able to do. And all that was a good business. People made a living from duck hunting. People made a living from oystering. People made a living from clamming. So they really provided the backbone with the wood to build the boats, white cedar in particular. So some of the early names associated with the area, as we said, Falkenberg, Andrews, Osborne, Cranmer, Willits, Ong. Ong is also associated, if you heard the story, of Ong's hat, which is on the way over towards Pepperton. Jacob Ong threw his hat up into the tree after an argument with a girl at a dance, and the hat stayed in the tree, and the little town that was there ended up being called Ong's Hat. All the same family. Ridgway, Hidgig, Mathis, Budd, Parker, Farrow, Adams, Allen, Leek, French, Loveland, Bartlett, Lippincott, Schwartz, and my last name, Mott. All these are very early names. Relatives of these folks were living in the area, you know, say from 1702 to right around 1715. This is when the beginning. Any genealogy that anyone has is going to have links to all these people. My genealogy in particular has almost every one of those brand names, if you go back to the husband and the wife and as it splits. Boat building was essential. This is another great story. You know, the Garvey is our traditional boat used for work in the bay. It's got a flat bottom. It's made out of white cedar. Before fiberglass, how did the boat stay afloat? Basically, the boat would absorb the water and swell, and the wood itself would keep the boat afloat. But the funny thing is, Gerard Sparrow and Farrow, we know from the lineage and the genealogies, was English. But the old story on how the Garvey got its name was there was this French guy named Jarvey or Jarvis, and they pronounced his name wrong, and that's how you got the term Garvey for the flat-bottom boat he built. So that's probably not the true story. We know that he probably built the boat, but why it was called the Garvey, we're still not 100% sure. It's not because his name was French and they said Garvey instead of Jarvis.
Mm-hmm. Clinker built Garvey.
Right.
My father always talked about those.
Yep, and it's the backbone. I mean, you just like we were saying about the inlets changing, you needed a flat bottom boat because you could run aground so easily. And if you run aground, you needed to be able to pull and get yourself and keep on going. 1704 is about the time that Edward Andrews builds the grist mill here in town. And therefore, that's when the town gets its name, Andrews Mill. This is another old picture of Main Street. I think this is from about where the light is, kind of looking back. This is well before my time, so I can't say I actually saw town, but I wish I did. I wish we still had a lot of those old buildings here in downtown. Okay, so you talked already about by 1709, the original meeting house was built. I talked about Thomas. Him and his father, Adam, ended up here. Between 1708 and 1714, they bought 435 acres in Egg Harbor. If you've been here long enough, if you remember down where right now there's the Great Bay Regional First Aid Building, right across from there, that's an area that was known as Mott's Farm. And that's some of the land they had purchased back many years ago. Today, there's not really much there anymore. But my Uncle Lincoln was the last first person to live there, and he moved down to North Carolina a few years ago. And since then, there's some townhouses and some things have been built there. But at one time, pretty much from that road, almost all the way down to Radio Road, and where Mathistown Road comes in, was really that whole piece of property. So it was a pretty large area. This is pretty cool. It talks about how people made a living in the area. So in 1719, the New Jersey Assembly was relatively young. One of the first things they're gonna pass is they're gonna pass a law preventing somebody from taking oysters between May and September. And the way I always remember it is you eat oysters in months that end in R. So in the summer months, you don't eat the oysters because that's when the oysters are developing and fertilizing and you don't want to mess the oysters. But the other thing is they protected the beds being harvested by strangers. So one of the first problems was people stealing other people's oysters. And I could still know stories from my family. If there was a family who someone got caught stealing somebody's clams or oysters, it was like a mark against that family forever and ever. That's how serious everyone took, because that was their livelihood. But in 1719, New Jersey passed that legislation. In 1714, that's when you start to see a Little Egg Harbor, and then it was officially incorporated in 1798. That's where you get the township of Little Egg Harbor. And then in 1740, just the what's going on in the area, that's when you start to see some of the first charcoaling operations start to develop in the pine lands in the area too. What was charcoal used for? Fuel, right? If you had a house, yeah, everything. If you had your home, your cooking was all pretty much charcoal. So the largest product ever exported from the area was charcoal. And this is a close-up of the mill dam. So here's Tucker Lake back here. Mm-hmm. There's the building right across the street that we're looking at parts of it today. When I was a little kid, I remember fishing back here all the time, because you would see all of the peanut bunker come flying up the stream, and you see these large schools of fish, and every once in a while, there'd be a big flash, and that was a snapper blue. And one of the things that I always tried, I never was successful, is we would take a coat hanger, we would straighten it out, and we'd sharpen the tip of the coat hanger, and we'd make a rope string, and the whole idea was to see when we saw the flash, to throw the hanger, and see if you could catch actually the snapper blue that was getting the bluefish. I never ever caught one, but it was something we tried on a regular basis. By 1745, things are really starting to kind of build out a little bit. Tuckerton is starting to become a little more prosperous. It's not known as Tuckerton at the time, but about that time, a guy named Reuben comes to the area. Reuben was of Quaker descent as well, and Reuben buys what was known as Short Beach, and that becomes Tucker Island. Tucker's Island, basically, it's going to become one of the first retreats along the Jersey Shore. So now, relatives and other Quaker families are going to be coming from Burlington, they're going to be coming from places like Cherry Hill, and they're going to come down to Tuckerton to go out to what's Tucker's Island as a first resort. And that's where you get that first idea of people traveling through. You hear stories about Quaker Bridge. Quaker Bridge is out between Atsine and Batstow, and where they would cross the Batstow River, they ultimately built a bridge. One of the stories is a few folks had drowned there, and that's why they built the bridge there. But they were literally traveling from that area all the way to Tuckerton, and those roads are still in existence today, which is pretty cool. Now, Reuben Tucker's son, who's born out on Tucker's Island, is Ebenezer Tucker. And we're going to find out later that's where the name Tuckerton comes from Ebenezer. In 1758, this is kind of interesting. So the first Native American reservation in the country is established over in the Chemung area. It's kind of along Route 206 today. There's Tabernacle, Chemung, and if you go down a little bit further, you run to Hampton. In that area was an area they were going to call Indian Mills, and that was the first Native American reservation. The Lenape were there, but interesting enough, we were talking about buying land. When the New Jersey State Assembly passed that, part of the act was the Native Americans, the Lenape who went there, had to give up any right to other lands in the state of New Jersey. So yes, they were given a reservation, but also at the same time, it was almost a way of codifying that they no longer had title to the lands that they originally inhabited beforehand. It was set up as kind of a working mill and working kind of farm. It didn't work out very good for the Lenape. By about 1802, most of the Lenape had either deceased or had moved on or kind of left the reservation and blended it back into a local southern New Jersey. There's a lot of people who have native Lenape heritage in southern New Jersey, and it comes directly from the Lenape that were living in the area. Not all of them went to the reservation, and not all of them left the reservation, but a majority of them went to New York State, and then ultimately from New York State ended out in Oklahoma. And the Lenape tribe today, for the most part, is centered in Oklahoma, because that's where, for the most part, they ended up. But even on my grandmom's side, there's definitely always stories of her father's mother may have had a Native American or Lenape heritage. So there's definitely a lot of Lenape in the population today. By the 1760s, that's when you're going to start to see the first forges and furnaces, they're going to use charcoal to take peat out of the ground, or what's going to become bog iron, and they're going to be a substantial industry in the Pine Barrens, up and down, as far as like up near where Wall is. There's a big facility up there. But there's 30 to 40 different furnaces and forges throughout the Pine Lands, where they're basically able to dig up bog iron, float it to a forge, or a furnace rather. They can melt it down, and then they can take it to the forge and make a product out of it. They make cannonballs, pots and pans, all the things that you can make out of bog iron. 1776, that's the Declaration of Independence. Pretty important time for everybody in America. Here, locally, it really was a financial boom for a lot of ways. Early on, with the shipping industry, and like I said before, when you had the postals, Philadelphia, New York, and Boston. If you brought a cargo into Philadelphia, New York, or Boston, you were going to have to pay a tax or a tariff, especially when it was all under England and the colonial government. But if you had snuck in a cargo into South Jersey, down into this area, you could get away with not paying any tax. So this area started a very, very early tradition of smuggling and shipbuilding and all coastal trade, kind of on the illicit side, because you didn't have to pay the taxes. So come the Revolutionary War, there was a lot of people with a lot of experience with ships. We talked about the whaling industry. So they all became pirateers, which was basically a licensed pirate. As long as they would go out and they would steal or do whatever they could to sabotage the English shipping coming up and down the coast. So people like Ebenezer Tucker, John Mathis, look at a lot of those early names, they had either purchased or they had part of these pirateering operations that made a lot of money during the Revolutionary War, stealing the British cargoes. They'd come in through Little Leg Inlet. They'd head up what was known as the Little Leg River, a place called Chestnut Neck is where they could unload a lot of their cargoes. A little bit further up the river was a place called the Forks, where they would unload them on the ships and wagons, and then they would sell those cargoes. Some of that cargo went maybe to the colonial army. Others were just put with pure profit. So a lot of the local families made a fair amount of money during the Revolutionary War. Here's a cool map. This is a 1976 map. And again, now you first see roads coming down to the shore. A road coming down this way, down to Cape May, coming back up. But you still see right here sandy, barren deserts. So the interior of the Pine Barrens still pretty much is undeveloped. But now you're starting to get pretty substantial coastal influences. And this is just a close-up where you still see you have Little Egg Inlet, you have Brigantine Beach, Absecon Beach, and then there's Great Neck here. So this is how the area starts to kind of fill in, and up here you have Barney Inlet. And then you see the river here, and for the first time, you see the Mullica. One of those early Swedes was a guy named Eric Mullica, who was over, say, in the closer to the Delaware, come through the Glassboro area. There's a place called Mullica Hill. That's all named after Eric Mullica, and eventually what was known as the Little Leg River becomes the Mullica River. So the Mullica River today is known for Eric Mullica. He ended up settling in the Lower Bank area, and that you see that change. This is the Great Egg Harbor River down here. Nested rebel pirates is how this area was described back then, so much so that in 1778, the English sent about 17 ships and about 200 soldiers from New York City, New York Harbor, down to this area to stop the pirateering, because it was having such a financial burden on the English Empire. They wanted to stop the iron making at Batstow. They also wanted to stop the salt works. Why was salt such an important resource during the Revolutionary War?
Preservation.
Preservation of meat. And on our meadows, the salt hay, they had a lot of operations where they could dry out the water and get the salt that was left over, so that was a pretty important resource. So when the English come down here in 1778, that's where they're coming. They're coming to stop the pirateers, stop the salt works, and hopefully get to Batstow where they're making cannonballs. Pretty much on all accounts, they fail. They do end up here. They end up scuttling some of their ships because they get stuck in the inlet or they get stuck in Great Bay. Around October 6th, they do land a force near Chestnut Neck, and there's a lot of local militia that kind of stuff fight. Chestnut Hex eventually burned down, but from that experience, the English realized that they're going to have a hard time here, so they go back into the bay. And then on October 15th, 1778, there's a guy named Captain Ferguson, who's also pretty famous because he had a rifle he designed called the Ferguson Rifle, and he's going to lead about 200 men onto what's Osborne Island at the time. He's going to head up Osborne Island, kind of along the route today is known as Radio Road, and he's going to attack some of the colonial soldiers that were sent here. George Washington had sent Casimir Pulaski and his Pulaski's Legion. They were in the Trenton area. He had dispatched them down to this area to protect the area, and some of Pulaski's pickets, or his like outer guard, is going to be attacked by Captain Ferguson's men. We today believe there was a massacre where about 30 to 50 soldiers of Pulaski's men were massacred, and then the English are going to head back down to the bay before Pulaski and his main force can catch up to him. The old story was that when they crossed Big Creek and Mystic Islands, they left soldiers behind and that pulled the planks or the nails out of the planks. So as soon as the English soldiers came back, they crossed the creek, they threw the planks into the water, and then when Pulaski and his cavalry got there, they couldn't catch him because they couldn't cross the creek. And they escaped back into the bay, and that was the skirmish that happened. And if you go down to Mystic Island today, you can see the Pulaski Monument. We don't exactly know where the soldiers were buried. Some people say the soldiers were buried around the monument. Other people say they were buried somewhere else, but we really don't know. We don't have an exact number. The number I've always been told or learned was around 30, maybe 50, and they were soldiers that were massacred in the battle in the pre-dawn days of October 15th. Pulaski becomes pretty famous, and so does Ferguson, and by the end of the Revolutionary War, I believe they both end up dying in Georgia in another battle, one of the very last battles of the Revolutionary War. Both Pulaski, who was Polish, who came to here to volunteer, and he led cavalry, and Ferguson was well-known because he had developed the Ferguson rifle, but they both end up dying in foreign soils here fighting the American Revolutionary War. To find out all about this, there's an absolutely fantastic book. The Batstow Citizens Committee sells the book. It was written by Franklin Kemp. He passed away, I think, probably about 10 years ago. But this book details everything in extraordinary detail. It's got reports from the soldiers that were there, and it's really the best account of what happened here in October of 1878. So there was actually Revolutionary War battles that took place right here in the area. I always, as a little kid, thought that was something that was pretty interesting. When I was a little kid, our Little League field was one of the fields associated with Mott's Farm. And one of the days when I was running around in the outfield, I stumbled and fell. And what I fell was a solid 6-pound cannonball. And I still have that cannonball to this day. Now, I don't know if it came from that or it came from something else, but it's always something I've always treasured, and I still have that 6-pound cannonball that I tripped over in Mott's Farm playing baseball. It was interesting because that was one of the bigger fields. So, like, Little League was always a big part of Tuckerton. And the field over here on Tip Stephen was a known ball field for years and years and years. But just in that little area, I played for the Pirates, and we practiced on one corner, and the Indians practiced on the other corner, and across the streets where first aid place is, that's where the Raiders played. So all those little league teams all practiced in the same proximity. So this is the monument to the privateers. This is out at Chestnut Neck, where the town was burned. So this is a large piece of bog iron, and that plaque lists all that there was 30 different privateer vessels from the area, and it lists the owners of all those ships and the ships' names. And that's right there in Chestnut Neck, which is right as you cross the Mullica River, headed towards Smithfield. Here's a list of all those captains. Let's see, here's Ebenezer. His ship was the Kitty, and these are all some of those, a lot of the whaleboats was what they used. They were basically a boat that could be rowed, but it had a mast, so it was a smaller boat. And it was basically, they would sneak up on the ship, And for the most part, the ships would just surrender. There really wasn't as much as a skirmish involved in most cases. This is the Plaskey's Monument. So this is right down off of Radio Road. And I think this was established by the Society of Cincinnati, and it honors the current ranks of soldiers that were massacred there under the command of Count Casimir Pulaski, and it was October 15th, 1778. There's usually still a ceremony. The society still comes, and every year there is usually some festivities that take place there at the monument, but also over at Chestnut Neck as well. Third port of entry. This is one of the things that you always hear about Tuckerton, that it was the third port of entry for the United States. Now, how can that be? Why would Tuckerton be more important than Boston, New York, or Philadelphia? Well, it's kind of interesting. I have it all laid out, and we'll kind of get to the bottom of whether or not we were really the third port of entry, or what that even means. We know from what I already said that there was all kinds of shipping, all kinds of smuggling, all kinds of pirateering. So it was definitely an area where there's a lot of coastal trade.
The First Congress, we have a copy at the museum. The writing of the First Congress specifies Burlington, Perth Amboy, and Little Lake Harbor in writing.
Yep, you got it. That's where it comes, right from on July 31st, 1789. New Jersey's assigned three port districts, Perth Amboy, Burlington, and Bridgeton, with Little Lake Harbor particularly signed out as a port of delivery in the District of Burlington. So there were three districts in New Jersey at the time. Little Lake Harbor was considered part of Burlington. Here's what we were just talking about. It's all right there from the First Congress. And at that time, George Washington nominated Ebenezer Tucker as the surveyor of the port of Little Lake Harbor. And he was confirmed by the U.S. Senate. So we were a port of entry. We just probably weren't the third port of entry for the United States, as some of the signs and local lore tends to say. In 1796, it was updated. So in 1796, Little Lake Harbor was established as a district itself. So at that point in time, instead of having three, New Jersey may have had four. There might have been another one as well. And from Barnegat Inlet to Brigantine, it was considered the Little Lake Harbor District. And the town of Tuckerton, by then Tuckerton had been known as Tuckerton for Ebenezer Tucker, was set up as the sole port of entry for the district. And then following that, same thing, Ebenezer was nominated by George Washington to be the first collector and inspector of revenue for the newly created district of Little Lake Harbor. So we were definitely a port of entry, just probably not the third in the United States. There it is, there. And Ebenezer goes on to become a congressman. I think he's elected to Congress in 1825. In 1829, he was also the local postmaster, but Reuben was still around, and when Ebenezer was in Congress, he transferred the postmaster job to his father, Reuben. So Reuben was the postmaster. The old story is that Ebenezer threw a big party, and everybody had a few, and they named the town after him, but again, that's probably a myth as well. We know from a lot of his writings, Ebenezer was a teetotaler, so he was not necessarily so much into drinking alcohol, so probably just because he was well known, he was certainly wealthy, he had owned a lot of the property, he did throw a party. There was definitely documentation of him having a celebration and the town being called Tuckerton therefore after. But it wasn't that everybody got drunk and they said, we're going to name the town Ebenezer, after Ebenezer. Oystering, this is an old postcard. It shows some of the seed oysters, people harvesting seed oysters, which then they could put out in other places and have more oyster beds. When the whaling kind of went away, the locals transitioned into clamming, oystering, duck hunting, deer hunting. That's how people made a living. Later on, they start to do things with the cranberries. You might go out in the woods and you collect sphagnum moss. You might collect some pine cones, and all that becomes working the cycle. And that's how a lot of local people made a living off of the natural resources. By the 1770s, that's really where the whaling goes away. Shellfishing and hunting become more important. 1789 is when you start to see the town Tuckerton, or the term Tuckerton, as a name of a community. It's not incorporated, it's not a borough, it's just a local name for the area was Tuckerton at that time.
1901 was when it was named.
Yep, later on Tuckerton succeeds basically from Little Lake Harbor and establishes its own borough. 1816 is interesting. Isaac Jenkins has a stage going from Philadelphia or Cooper's Ferry to Tuckerton. It's a 2-day round trip. But we know even prior to 1816, even closer to the Revolutionary War, there was stage lines traveling from Cooper's Ferry to Tuckerton. So Isaac Jenkins wasn't the first, but he definitely was established permanently around that 1816 time. Here's Ebenezer again. He was in the 25th and the 29th the 1825 and 1829 elected to Congress. There's a speech that he gave, and I have yet to see the story. If you look up online, you can find an old article from the Beacon that talks about this speech Ebenezer Tucker gives, and it's a two-part series. So the first part talks all about Ebenezer, and the second part has the actual speech. I've never been able to find the second part to see what he actually said when he addressed Congress sometime between 1825 and 1829. But it'd be great to see what he was saying when he spoke to Congress. Another traditional vote is the sneak box. The sneak box is usually giving credit to Hazleton Seaman, and that was invented around 1836, and basically it's a duck hunting boat. The area is known for duck hunting, also known for decoys, both made out of Atlantic white cedar. Cedar was a really important part of the area. Our roofs on our houses, our shingles, cedar was used for almost everything you could think of back in those days. Another word for the sneak box is the devil's coffin. They literally shipped ducks by the barrel out of Tuckerton. So Tuckerton was shipping ducks to Philadelphia, New York, to restaurants all over the world. When you go out to dinner today, usually steak's the main entree. Back in those days, waterfowl was pretty much the main entree on a lot of those restaurants. So it was a really important resource. There was a whole market duck hunting business from the area. Cranberries start in the 1830s, 1840s. You start to see people cultivating cranberries. To this day, if you go up off of Poor Man's Parkway and you head into the woods, you can find the old abandoned cranberry bog that somebody had years and years ago, had cleared out an area, it's about the size of a football field, and it drops down, and you can still pick wild cranberries just growing. They weren't wild, they were planted there at some point by somebody, but it's right off of Poor Man's Parkway. Tucker's Island was built in 1848. Over time, Tucker's Island, like we said, just slowly got kind of moved, and I think by the way, I want to say, was it 1928? I can't remember off the top of my head. Eventually, the building itself falls into the ocean. The Ryder family, in particular, was out there for the most part, and they were many generations of the Ryder family were the lightkeepers at their own Tucker's Island. 1854 is things really start to change. There is a railroad from Camden to Atlantic City, and that really is interesting because the money that paid for that was the money from the bog iron industry. So the bog iron industry was more or less money from Philadelphia. Once the bog iron industry left the Pine Barrens, they found iron and they found coal in northeast Pennsylvania. So it was cheaper to make iron up there than it was here. But they took their profits and that money went into be invested into the railroad. So the bog iron industry kind of leaves and the next stage for the Jersey Shore is the tourist industry. And that really starts with the railroad to Atlantic City in 1854. 1861, there's a really interesting poem written by Leah Blackman, and it's by the ladies of Little Lake Harbor to the IRAP infantry of Little Lake Harbor men. Most of the soldiers that fought for New Jersey during the Civil War were from southern New Jersey. There was a huge Quaker influence, as we talked about. There was a lot of abolitionist feeling in southern New Jersey. Northern New Jersey had a lot of big textile industry. So the textile industry basically was making clothes from southern cotton. So northern New Jersey was more aligned actually with the South during the Civil War than southern New Jersey. Now today, we think about southern New Jersey as being more rural, and in some ways would identify more with the South. But during the Civil War, the majority of soldiers who volunteered to fight for the Union from New Jersey were from South Jersey. Most of the folks who fought from this area were considered Burlington County at the time, and so they were part of the Irak infantry. Irak is a family name associated with Burlington, and there was a General Irak who was one of the local regiment commanders, and that's where that term comes from. Here is the poem. Leah Blackman is undoubtedly probably one of the best reasons why I can talk about Tucker in history, because she put pen to paper. She was able to write down the stories from different generations. We were talking about the genealogy a little bit earlier, and one of Leah Blackman's books, she writes a history of Little Egg Harbor, and she clearly states that when she looks at the names and the people, it doesn't always add up. And she theorizes in the book that some people had clipped some of the branches off some of the local family trees. As you can see, she lists all the people who lived in town at the time, and there are definitely people that are missing, families that are missing, and that was just, you know, the way the records were kept. If somebody wasn't as popular as somebody else, they might have not put them down in the book at the right date when they were born. So there's lots of kind of gaps. And like we talked about earlier, the history is always, whoever writes the history generally has an impact on how the history is interpreted. But without Leah Blackman, we really wouldn't have near the knowledge we have about half the things I talked about today. So she's really a credit, particularly being a lady in those days, to be, you know, to have the fortitude to write books and have the information is really important. Here's a cool picture. This is 1878. This shows the mill pond. This is the little town of Tuckerton. My dad always tells the story when he was a kid. You had east of the Danvers, west of the Danvers, and east of the Danvers. You know, when I grew up, you had pretty much Tuckerton and West Tuckerton, but there was a distinct line between one side of the dam and the other side of the dam. Not so much today, that's kind of changed, but back in those days, it was pretty important which side of the dam you were from. We live in this house right here that says Jenny Warren, and years ago we were doing a renovation project, and we took out a false ceiling, and up above we had the rafters and the cedar logs, and we saw JW pointing up in tar where he had put his name, I guess, when he had built the house. The house we live in, we think, was built between 1860, because it's not on the 1860 map, and it's on this 1878 map. But when you live in an old house, every time you start a project, you never know what you're gonna find out. It's like opening a can of worms, because there's laugh and all kinds of stuff, and we find newspapers in the walls, all kinds of salt hay in the walls, all kinds of stuff. So here's the good old town of Tuckerton. A lot of Farrows, a lot of Prices, Lippincott, you know, all those names that we talked about. Andrews, Bartlett, this is this area right here by the mill dam. Farrow, so here's the old Tuckerton Creek. This is kind of the recreational time, like the heyday of Tuckerton in a lot of ways. Might be the late half of the 1800s, early half of the 1900s. That's when there's a lot of sportsmen coming. A lot of people coming to fish the area. Certainly a lot of people duck hunting. These are people out racing sneak boxes. So this is probably one of the local yacht clubs. 1869, that's really when the bog iron period ends. By about the end of the Civil War, you kind of lose the bog iron influence in South Jersey. 1871, 1872, the railroad is built from Whiting to Tuckerton. So Tuckerton was so important in the 1870s, it got its own railroad. So it's really the second. Atlantic City was first, but Tuckerton itself was second. People would come to Tuckerton by rail, and then they could take a steamboat over to Good Beach Haven, over to the island. And 1891 is kind of important because that's when Ocean County's formed. So at the time, you had Burlington and Monmouth County for the most part, and Little Egg Harbor was at the very tip of Burlington County, at the very southern end of Monmouth County, and what is now Ocean County was set up in 1891. So that's when you get Ocean County. And in 1901, as we talked about earlier, that's when Tuckerton Borough kind of decides they want to be separate from Little Egg Harbor Township, and the first mayor is Frank Austin. in 1901. 1912 is the Tucker Wireless. You can go down Regular Road today and you can still see this big concrete box. Well, that was a radio tower that was, well, I'll get to that later in a minute. Here we are in this Friends Meeting House. This is a picture from 1915. And this is the second meeting house. My understanding is by around the Civil War, the Quaker church kind of went through like a reformation or a reform, and they weren't as maybe as strict as they might have been. And the old church was very strict. And in a lot of ways, that transition was one of the reasons why they took down the old building and built the new building. I don't know that to be sure. Is that correct or around the right story?
Well, it was a split in the Quakers, the ones that were more worldly, and then the ones that were stricter and more simpler.
Okay.
But the meeting house itself here, on the same spot as the original one, is basically because of the population increase.
Okay.
It was, the original meeting house was a little one-story cabin, basically, which is typical, which is similar to the one that's in Barnegat now.
Okay.
But the second one was built because of the population increase and optimism in 1863 to hold 200 people.
Right.
However, that's been a peak. It went down to about 1893. People joined the Methodists and Baptists. A lot of people joined the military in the Civil War and the Spanish-American War. And between 1900 and 1985, only met during the summer. But there wasn't a split, there was actual growth, but it peaked in 1863. Okay.
Yeah. So it just increased the size of the other house for more people?
Right, because the population increased between, you know, 150 years.
Okay.
What happened was they were still strictly enforcing not marrying non-Quakers, so if a Quaker man married a Methodist woman, they would leave here and they would. If the Methodist church along with their 10 kids.
Right.
So instead of losing one member, they ended up losing.
Right. Yep. Yeah, my family's similar.
Right next door.
Adam, he married a woman. Her last name was Hewitt, when they were still in Long Island. But she was of Dutch heritage. And so at that point, you don't really see them written so much more in the Tuckman Quaker book. Because that's what I guess at that point, since he had married out, then they were part of the town, but they just weren't part of the official record.
Right.
That same concept too. We were talking about the names. When you go into like the Pine Barrens and say out by Chatsworth and Jenkins Neck and all those little towns, it's really a lot of the same family names. So they had really close connections, and that's how they were able to go back and forth with all those natural resources. But you know, a community, and as the community got bigger, they just kind of spread out and help each other out. Here's a ship built. This is a size of one of the large ships that was being built in the area. We know from the records that more than 800 or 181 schooners, sloops, catboats were built and launched from Forkett River to Nicoque Creek. That's right down south of Chestnut Neck. In Tuckerton in particular, between 1784 and 1929, 19 out of 44 boats were more than 100 tons gross weight, and 14 of them were 44 more than 100 feet long. So we're talking really, really big boats, coastal ships. They could go from here all the way down to the Caribbean and come all the way back up to Massachusetts. Pretty large. And in 1844, there were 50 vessels licensed out of the port of entry for here in Tuckerton. But like I said, that's a large area. You know, we're talking from Barnegat Inlet all the way down to Little Egg or Brigantine Inlet. So it's a big area.
But Joel, did they have to come to Tuckerton?
No, I don't think so. They just were licensed and registered in Tuckerton. So they may go walking down and go over. But that's one of the interesting things about the idea of Tuckerton Seaport. There really wasn't a Tuckerton Seaport, so to speak. I mean, there was shipping and coastal, and all those buildings were taking place, but it wasn't like a place like, say, Mystic Seaport, where you had like a big harbor and you had lots of ships. So that is a little, you know, different how you look at it. But the whole area, even places like up like Forked River, all those shallow bays, there was all kinds of shipbuilding from Forked River all the way down to Mays Landing that all kind of funneled through. And at this time, Tuckerton was the only office. They had to be licensed in Tuckerton because that's where they did all the paperwork.
And then they had to pay taxes
there,
is that it?
I'm not sure about it. I'm not sure exactly how it worked.
Yeah, I read that one of the reasons Tuckerton was made the official seaport and Tucker was the tax collector. The government wanted everything to go through the official port because that way they could collect taxes as the ship stopped.
Yep.
Well, if they went in through the other rivers and streams, they could bypass the tax collector.
Sure.
So that was one of the reasons for the designation as official seaport.
Yep.
We want you, it was kind of like a toll booth.
Right, yeah.
You go in there, you collect and gave your money to Ebenezer Tucker.
Right, yep. Here's some more information on the railroad. So the railroad was set up. It basically was going from Whiting. This was the Jersey Southern Line or the Jersey Central Railroad later. Basically went from Whiting to Toms River, and they had a spur that would come down through portions of Forked River today, Bamber, Lacey, down through Waretown and Barnegat, Manahawkin, all the way down, you know, all the little towns along the way, Sienna, Nieta, Staffordville, West Creek, Parktown, and then Tuckerton. And then there's the old story of the Edge Cove where they would run out to the steamer. You guys have probably heard lots of stories about the old Mantown Railroad where they put a sail up and use those old tracks to run the oysters back and forth from Edge Cove. I grew up down on Cedar Street, so when I was a kid, I'd go out onto the meadows and I could go all the way out to Edge Cove. And if you knew what creeks to jump, you could make yourself all the way out to the bay. You just had to be careful because you usually would come home pretty muddy and pretty dirty because sooner or later you would jump and you wouldn't make it across the creek and you'd end up in some of that meadow mud. It ran for 75 years and in 1936 is when the last train ran. And there's a story here. This is from the local newspapers. It talks about a crammer, a rudder, and a Beeloff, all the local names. And they were the last three guys on the train. And it was basically trucks and busing took them out of business, and that's why they closed it in 1936. Eventually, they put the causeway, and they had the train actually going right to Beach Haven. So we cut ourselves out of our own success in some ways. This is another photograph of the old railroad. It was revived as a Southern New Jersey Railroad and started again in 1937. Ran for only a couple years, it didn't last very long. And by October of 1940, the tracks are gone. Where our Jill's grandma's property is, you can still see the old railroad bed, where the railroad station has been over where Tucker Lumber is, but you can still see where the old tracks, there's a berm that cuts right through a swamp where the old train tracks were back in the day. And just a little bit on local culture. Work in the bay, it's where the term baying comes from. There are people who were duck hunters, fishermen, crammers. Could be a guy out for deer hunting in the wintertime, but you always kind of made a living. My grandma used to talk a lot about, she was born in 1916, lived through the Depression. And I said, well, how was it? Was it having horrible? And she said, to be honest, it really was no different than any other time. We still were fishing, famine, and we had plenty of food, and we didn't have much money in the first place, so we really didn't know any difference. From the resources, you were able to make a living without having to worry about the banks and the stock market and all that kind of stuff. We talked about the Garvey and the sneak box, and decoys. Tuckerton's been known for Barnegat Bay style decoys for years and years. One of the most prolific carvers was a guy named Harry B. Shorts. Harry's brother was very famous. Harry's brother's son was also named Harry. He just was down in Seaville. I think he passed away a few years ago. But there was a lot of carvers. There was a guy named Nathan Raleigh Horner up in Manahawkin. There was Hurley Conklin. Some of the most sought after decoys were from this area. Every little town had its own version. So this is, Harry Shorts was considered a Tuckerton style. But if you go up the road a little bit to Parkertown, there was the Parker family, a well-known carver named Jay Parker. He had his own style. And so all these little towns had their own style of a barn you made decoy, which is basically made out of white cedar. There's a box on the top, the head was carved separately, and then they were nailed together with hollowed in the middle, and so they would float like a real bird. And they were very, you know, they weren't pretty, but they were effective. And if you got it shot or if it got it cracked, you can throw it in the wood spot and use it for firewood. That's why they're so valuable today, if they survived from back in those days, because they were a tool. They weren't like a thing you could put on the mount, which is totally completely different than decoys today. But there are some examples of two birds that were carved by Harry. And then we talked about the market duck hunting. This is a great shot. So in like the heyday, this is probably from the 1920s, this is the fishing fleet down in Tuckerton Beach from the old Tuckerton Yacht Club. So people literally came all over the state, all over other states, to come to Tuckerton just to go out and fish in the waters of Tuckerton Bay, Great Bay, and we were very well known for the fishing fleet there. I'll just get into it real quick. Here's the Stink House, or the old fish factory down on Crab Island. It's looked like this my whole entire life. Anybody older than me remembers when it was actually in production, and they can remember the way the wind blew, and they can see what was going on. Oh yeah. So this is the story behind it, some of them anyway. For the most part, Joseph Warren State Forest, the guy who owned what's Batsco Village, he was an entrepreneur from Philadelphia. One of his enterprises was he purchased what was official the works between 1871 and 1888 down there, which is known as Crab Island. They were making fish oil. Around the turn of the century, 1902, it was sold to the Newport Fertilizer Company. What they were doing was they were taking the trash, because Atlantic City was booming back in those days. They would take all the trash from Atlantic City, they'd bring it to Crab Island, they'd burn it, and they would sell that as fertilizer. Amazing. And all the gunk went into the bed. And probably was one of the reasons why later on we had a lot of problems with our oysters, because of all that gunk that got put into the bed when they were using it as a fertilizer plant. It was used that way until about the 1930s. And like I said, my grandfather was born on Little Beach, which is right across from where the Coast Guard station is, not too far away from where the fish factory was. And he remembers, and there's an article, a Rutgers PhD student did a story about it, what it was like. And they interviewed Elmer, and he said he was a little kid, and his dad from the life-saving station had to take something over to the fish factory, and how god-awful it was. There was carcasses of cows and horses and all this nasty stuff, and all the trash that was being burnt down. He could, and in the article, he says he could see it running down the banks into the bay. And then in 1935, this is more local history, Howard Smith and the Smith Fishing Company bought it. More, we see bags around town, you see the Smith, and that's what they were doing. They were making a fish meal, which is really used from the Manhattan or the bunker. So back in those days, they would fly planes on the shore, along the coast, and they'd find these large pods of the peanut bunker. They would go out with the ships, catch them, bring them in, and that's when it was processed into fish meal. And that was right on up into, it was eventually closed in 1974. Right about that, I was born in 72, so right about that time. Jill's grandfather ran one of the tugs, and his brother Eddie ran one of the other tugs. And if you go down Seven Bridges Road at Little Sheep's Head, it's really straight. Well, Little Sheep's Head originally had some big bends in it, but when they had the fish factory, they cut the channel in, and they went right from that road right to the fish factory. So that's where they would run the tug back and forth to bring in, supplies and things there to the fish factory. In 1980, there was a big fire out there, and a lot of the buildings burnt, but there's still iron. You can still see the water tower. It's kind of a local landmark. I think there's been a couple over time, projects that kind of clean up and take it back to natural, but then there's always been a big uproar. It's like a local landmark, and people like it that it's there now, so it'll probably always stay pretty much the way it is.
People might do some flounder fishing out there from time to time. This is what it looks like from Seven Bridges Road. It's like the iron skeleton is still there and the concrete buildings are there, but everything else is gone. This is Mystic Islands in the background. Here's the wireless. The wireless was built in 1912. It was demoed in 1955 to start some of the lagoons that became Mystic Islands. It was built by a German company, the Homan Company. During World War I, we took it back and the Navy used it. Eventually, it was sold to RCA, and it was a transatlantic radio tower, so it could transmit back and forth. One of the other local lures is that there was a message from that tower that said Sink Lucy, and so one of the theories is that maybe the Germans said, the Lusitania, that kind of has been debunked over time. But when it was up, it was 820 feet, and at the time, the only thing taller was the Eiffel Tower. The world, so it was a pretty big feat. You can still see the concrete blocks that were the anchor points down in Mystic Islands.
U-boat number 30, 3,000 miles from here, was one that killed the Lusitania.
Yep.
It wasn't us.
Right. Tuckerton had a brief but well-known speedway in the early 1950s. There was a half-mile dirt track over where Little Lake Harbor School is for the most part. You can still see the iron brick pillars there as you go in. It was quite successful. It ran from 1950 through 1951. And here's a picture of one of the local racers. This was a local guy named Bob Dawson. And he had died in the summer of 1951. And when he passed away, he had an accident. I think he survived the accident, but it must have been a head injury. And a few days later, he died, and he was a local. And a lot of the local people kind of lost the taste for the racetrack after that. So that following October, it had its last race, and it was shut down. And it was bringing people in from all around the state. It was kind of a regional thing, but it only had a very short-lived after Bob Dawson passed away from an accident there.
There was a wood track just south of here a little bit called Amatol.
Yep.
Amatol Loading. Well, when that closed, they built a wood track for racing.
I always liked race cars when I was a kid, so I always found it neat that there was a racetrack in Carpenter. I was always disappointed that it didn't go further.
I think there was one on 72 also.
Okay. Just to wind things up, here's just a couple shots. So this is from the Mill Dam looking down Tuckerton Creek. You can see there's a big stink box. There's some Garveys. There's a couple bigger cat boats back there. Just some of the working boats.
Swimming.
Yep, that's what I thought, like about that. That's pretty neat to catch that. Because taking a photograph of Brokeback Moose is a lot more work. It wasn't just flipping out the camera and clicking, or your phone. And here's that same angle. So this is the old firehouse. This is right where Stewart's is today, pretty much. That was the old town firehouse there. There was a couple other big buildings along that way. There's the dam, the grist mill. I love this picture because this intersection is different. So this is from looking right over there, looking this way, and the Indian used to be right over here. But I remember as a little kid, you'd be on your bike and you'd have to cross this huge stretch because Great Big Boulevard comes in and it was a big wide area. So when you left over here by the lake and you had to drive all the way across, you were taking your life in your hands because it was such a big. Now they've kind of repositioned it and the intersection is the same. But I'll never forget trying to cross that on my bike, or even trying to run across it when you were a little kid.
It was a circle.
Yeah.
Because I remember you could turn around.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But not a true circle. Most circles have like five roads, but this one was a circle, but with it traditional.
Yeah, it was quite unique, and I always wondered about the Native American statue, and I always thought it had something to do with the local history, but it turns out, really, it was part of the Redmond, and I think Howard Francis, who was also a Redmond person, was able to get someone else was giving the statue away from North Jersey, and he said, well, we'll take it, and that's how it ended up here in Tuckerton.
Redmond.
Yep. And this is from looking that way, right there where the Gerber's is, or used to be. So that's the Emporium. We're right across the street from there, basically. Mm-hmm. This is looking the other way, so this is from the light. looking down towards the lake here. There's, yep.
Is that the picture you got?
Yeah.
That's the exact same picture?
No, not the exact same, it's further up.
And then this is from Seven Bridges Road looking back up to town sometime in July, I think, when the sun was going down.
Oh, wonderful. And,
beautiful.
That's my email address. If anybody has any questions or whatever, want to follow up with anything, you can get a hold of me there. And like I said, I work for the New Jersey Pine Lands Commission, and really my job is to educate people about the pine lands and the local history and heritage.
That's wonderful.
Thank you. That's a tough talk because there's so many topics where you can get sidetracked. And you could do a whole program on half the things I talked about.
We have so many
history here. Yeah. Yeah, as a kid growing up,
that's my grandmother's house.
Oh, and what's the name?
Was the local history. And then